So I'm often asked about my own healing journey and my own illness and, you know, how that's influenced me. So here's my story, or at least a part of it. The biggest part probably was when I was about 30 years old and I started getting this intractable pain in my chest, in my heart. I felt flu-like symptoms. I felt just lethargy, fatigue. And it would come and it would go and it would come and it would go. And over a period of, you know, a year or so, it got to be really debilitating. In fact, I'd even gone to my GP several times and I knew him well. We were professional peers and I said to him, hey, listen, do you think it could be relapsing viral pericarditis, as you do with your doctor? And he went, your ECG is normal. I don't think so. And fair enough. Anyway, you know, fast forward about 8 months later, you know, I ended up collapsing on the floor with crushing chest pain and being blue lighted in directly to coronary care. Lots of morphine, flatlined in the coronary care unit. Had a very interesting experience during that time. And there was an inch of swelling either side of my heart in something called the pericardium. And so, yes, I had got relapsing pericarditis. So I have no problem with my GP. It's a very difficult thing to diagnose. And actually, you often won't see anything on the ECG, only a very small change in the ST curve. But you really need an echocardiogram to see the swelling. I did get good care for that, excellent care, and I had a lot of steroid treatment, which took the swelling down. The only problem was, every time I came off the steroids, then the swelling just came back, and then there I would be back again, chest pain. Now, I'm not exaggerating when I say it took me 8 years to actually go through my own healing journey and figure out, quite literally, physician, heal thyself. So it has been probably the greatest teacher. My own illness has been the greatest teacher that I've ever had, quite frankly. I had to go on a long journey and go, well, okay, what do I know? What do I know about my own interests already with patients who, you know, they have these problems that keep coming back, or why do I see so many people with irritable bowel problems and lower back problems, or people who have shoulder problems with a long history of maybe thyroid, underactive thyroid, or tonsillitis a lot as a child and things. Is this a coincidence? Maybe not. And so I'd already begun to explore things like craniosacral therapy, energy medicine, Chinese medicine, different ways of thinking that might have an answer that my conventional Western training didn't have. But I explored that, did some of my own work, and still I was getting stuck. And so I then pursued, I entered into martial arts, got into a Zen journey, really started looking at my own mind, looking at the mind-body relationship in that way and tying that in. And then exploring what we might now call the somatic world. And certainly back then, I won't say it didn't exist, but it was certainly not mainstream, and certainly nothing that I knew about of somatic therapy, because this work was beginning to evolve back then. You know, Peter Levine, Babette Rothschild, these people were doing this, but it certainly wasn't something that was readily accessible and that I'd ever come across. So I looked at my own knowledge that I had and tried to blend it together, and started coming into contact with my own body, practicing internal meditations, noticing what was happening, using visualizations, using all sorts of different tools that I picked up throughout my career, and kept looking at different things. And in essence, it's through exploring that I was able in the end to be able to get off the steroids. And I can say that for the last 10, 12 years, I've not had any episodes of pericarditis. And interestingly, another issue that I used to have from time to time was gout. and needed medication for that. And I don't need any medication for that either. And that's another chronic inflammatory, effectively autoimmune type disease. And so what? Well, I honestly feel that I can resonate so often with my patients that I'm working with when they feel the struggles of, oh, you know, I just thought I was doing okay, and or I'm angry at my body and why won't it work, and I often say to them, look, you know, I've been in that chair and I've cried and I've got angry and I've done years, I did 7 years of psychotherapy work as well as somatic work. I've done a lot of work. Now, mercifully, I can package things up a little bit quicker for people, but it isn't necessarily a 6-week journey. Any good somatic work will often take months, maybe even a couple of years. To be able, I think, to resonate with my patients now is a great gift, and I think they find that supportive too. So, yeah, I stretched far and wide to try and find answers about the mind and the body not really being separate, about how we can come back into commune with our own bodies. Because I remember saying, you know, it feels like my body's my enemy and I hate this thing. And why won't it let me do what I want it to do? And then, you know, you just find that you're in an argument with it. And you're just fighting, and just like any other relationship, if you're just in your own corners battling against one another, then nothing resolves. And I could even see the parallels between sort of more direct techniques that I might have done of manipulations, or even direct fascial release, which, you know, perhaps we'll do another video on sometime. And my preference towards more often, not always, but more often indirect techniques, where the best thing to do with two people that are actually in conflict, well, sometimes they might need a little bit of space apart, but very often is to help them come together. Yeah, in a way to see that they're not actually, they're both hurting and that they're trying to communicate with each other and that it's just not getting through. Yeah, well, pain is communication and your body's just crying out and it's trying to tell you something. But in the words of a great book of one of my teachers, Peter Levine, in an unspoken voice, the thing is, it just doesn't use words. You know, emotions, they don't have words necessarily. We just put a word upon it. And when we start to really realize, and some other training and work that I've done of neurodevelopmental psychology, looking at my own childhood, looking at how our patterns of our body's processing begins, and also inner child work, you know, sometimes it's a great idea to really feel when we come back into commune with our own bodies and come back in with this inner child that's just trying to say, hey, you know, I'm hurting here. Help, you need to listen to this. You know, and I can feel emotional now because I can remember the times when I actually had communication effectively in that way and cried deeply as I finally came into contact with this inner child that had been trying to talk to me and that I felt so bad that I'd been pushing it down. Yeah, but it loved me enough to be persistent, to keep talking to me. It took me to a coronary care unit before I listened. Yeah, but then it eventually went, okay, so I love you enough to be able to do the work. Yeah, to figure out so that we can actually communicate again as one and be friends. And now my body's my friend and not my enemy. Hi, I'm Roger. Thanks for watching the video. Hope you enjoyed it. Don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons.